I first became aware of your music was a society's child. And I think that's probably the first time most Americans heard your music.
That was the first time I made music, so.
You were 14 years old when you wrote that?
I was 14 when I wrote it and cut it, and then 15 when it became a hit.
Now, that that was a groundbreaking record. For the first time, it talked about interracial romance.
Black boy meets white girl. Nobody likes it.
And I would love to know what went on inside that record company when you're talking about your wonderful album. You're trying to break a new artist, and by today's standard, you never say, hey, let's take the most controversial song and put that out as a single.
Well, it was, first of all, in those days, you cut the single first. We didn't even cut the album until the single had been out for 6 months or 5 months. So you went with what you had. Society's Child was cut originally for Atlantic Records under a production deal that the producer Shadow had. And when Atlantic got the master, they gave it to us, said they couldn't put it out. And Shadow and his people started trying to find a record company. We went through 22 companies in the United States, all of whom passed. And then Ver Folkbase came along. They were starting a new label. I honestly think they wanted it as a tax loss, but they took the record and put it out. And I think they released it that May or June. And it got a lot of play in New York. FM radio was just really starting. Murray the K was running a big FM station here. It was completely commercial free. They played it every 2 hours. And it got little areas like Flint, Michigan or Philadelphia, but it didn't get any kind of national support because of the subject matter. There was an industry magazine called The Gavin Chart. Bill Gavin, who would not meet an artist because he felt it would taint him, said that this song was an out-of-the-box hit. Too bad it would never see the light of day.
I want to be clear, you said Atlantic had the first rights to it.
Atlantic had first rights. They paid for it. And it was a very expensive record by those day standards. It took 6 hours to record.
And they couldn't put it out because
they wouldn't put it out. And I actually give them huge credit because years later, Jerry Wexler, who was head of Atlantic, came to me at a Grammy Awards in a very public arena and apologized loudly.
I mean, it's shocking to hear because Atlantic has a great tradition of R&B, and in fact, a lot of white performers record R&B for Atlantic and had to good success. And apparently, they learned their lesson from their experience with your record. But so, who owns the rights to Society's Child now?
MGM, probably.
So it's still out there worldwide.
As far as I know, yeah, they issued a package 2 years ago called Society's Child. It hasn't been.
You ended up with a huge hit. In large part because of the power of television.
Yeah, those were the days, you know, when there were only 7 channels. So Leonard Bernstein heard about the song and featured it for 15 minutes, and me incidentally to that, on a show called Inside the Pop Revolution, I think. And it was on Sunday night prime time. So all of a sudden we were legitimate, and he made a big fuss over the fact that in America you couldn't get a record like this played because of the censorship. And next morning, KRLA Radio in L.A., which was the big West Coast station, took out a full-page ad apologizing. It was pretty unprecedented. I didn't really understand it. You know, I was 15. I just thought, oh, this is cool. And it began to snowball, and it was on the charts for a year after that.
And you could not have had a better mentor, somebody to speak up for you. And it reminds me of when Ed Sullivan vouched for Elvis and said he's a really fine
guy. Right, he's a nice boy.
Now, don't get me wrong. I said I liked some of those sounds. There's a good deal I don't like and wouldn't dream of defending. I don't like volume for its own sake, or the way the words are often drowned out by drums and amplifiers. I don't like the amateur quality of some of the writing and the out-of-tune singing. This music can be coarse, faddish, a victim of its own sameness. And yet when it's good, it's irresistible. After all, there are pros and cons to everything, especially in a popular art. And the cons are well enough publicized. We're here to examine the pros. And we're in luck because I've managed to find one song that incorporates so many of these pros that we can enjoy them all at once. It's a marvelous song called Society's Child, written, astonishingly enough, by a 15-year-old girl named Janis Ian. This tune is very well known among the followers of pop music, but you may not have heard it since it's been withheld by most of the radio stations for reasons unknown to me, although probably having to do with its subject matter, which is, as you'll see, somewhat controversial. But apart from the words, Society's Child contains many of the musical joys we've talked about, and some we haven't. like fascinating sounds, both natural and electronic, like a strange use of harpsichord and that cool, nasty electric organ. There are astonishing key changes and even tempo changes, ambiguous cadences, unequal phrase lengths, the works. And we're even luckier to have Janis Ian herself here to sing it for us. Listen hard to Society's Child. Sassy retort of the organ at the end, that voice, those words, and that key change. But for now, this is the way they must remain. They say, I can't see you anymore, baby. Oh, Janis, how did you ever write such a thing at the age of 15? You're a great creature.
Thank you.
I think that's quite a remarkable job for a girl of your age, and I congratulate you on what I'm sure is going to be a brilliant career.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming to see us.
Thank you for inviting me.
So it would seem that the kids of our pop generation have a lot to say. Actually, what Janis has written is a short social document, not a satire, not a protest, just a picture of a social trap.
It was real schizophrenic, you know. On the one hand, I was getting to work with people like Joplin and Hendrix and the Stones and hang out backstage with them and run into them at airports or play after hours in the Village. And on the other hand, a lot of the time, groups of 10 and 20 people would buy tickets to my concerts and sit together. And when I hit Society's Child, they would start screaming, kill the nigger loving bitch, or and chanting that and try and drive me off the stage. So it was a very uncomfortable time for me in a lot of ways, a time that holds great memories and absolutely horrendous memories.
Yeah, does it affect you at that age and people reacting that strongly to your work?
Very badly. Yeah. I think my assumption became that I was going to die on stage. I assumed that sooner or later one of these people would get through the police at the front of the stage or would bring a shotgun or something.
It's interesting. I've read that of other performers of the era. Phil Oakes was always afraid he was going to be murdered. Were there times when you thought, you know, I really ought to record safer music?
Well, it's a problem because I think I don't know how much choice an artist who only records their own songs has in what they write. You know, you can try and tilt it toward that, but every time I've tried, the results have been dismal. You know, I write what I write, and I think part of it is just if you have a respect for your talent, for the gift that you've been given, then a lot of the time it's the gift leading you.
What is it that won you the Writing Society's Child? I mean, how does that come to you?
If I knew, I would bottle it. I don't know. I was sitting on a bus on my way home from school, and I was just thinking about writing a song. I've been writing songs for about 2 years, and it started to come. Took a couple of months to write it. And I remember when we did the recording session, Shadow took me outside and said that he wasn't telling me what to do, but if I would change one word, if I would change the word black, he could guarantee me a number one record. And another person who was with us looked at me and said, you start one and you'll hold forever. And I thought, well, if this is my entire future for the rest of my life, I may as well start off right. I can always sell my soul later.
Without the word black in there, would it not have been understood to be interracial?
Wouldn't have been controversial. I could have made him a boy from the wrong side of the tracks, like everybody else was doing, you know, left it open. He was a poor boy, she was a rich girl.